everyone. Thank you so much for tuning in today for a very special episode of Spotlight, the Scientist in School. It is my great pleasure to introduce today's guests. As Executive Director of Scientist in School, I have the great honor of collaborating with a talented, creative, tireless team of workshop presenters and staff across Ontario and Alberta. They number about 400 now, and their dedication to our mission to ignite scientific curiosity in children through creative, very hands-on workshops where the children become the scientists, working under scientists, in one word, is quite simply boundless. Today, a handful of those people will be the stars of our Spotlight episode. We want to share just how far we've come along in our charity's COVID impact recovery journey. I could talk endlessly, really, about the inspiring and creative and innovative ways our staff and presenter group have adapted. They've really imagined and rebuilt our programs virtually, but then we'd be here forever. So what I do want to say before I turn you over to the team is a huge thank you on behalf of everyone at Scientist in School for supporting our charity, especially during such a challenging time. And now it's really my great pleasure to turn you over to the team.
Hi, everyone, and welcome back to Spotlight with Scientists in School. Today, I'm having a conversation with not one, but five scientists who also happen to be my friends and colleagues at Scientists in School. Welcome, everyone.
Hello.
Let's go around the table and meet everyone. We have Heather Staines, who is our Hello. Team lead. Diane Smit, Program Coordinator with Alberta.
Hello.
Hello, Diane. We have Tina Scherz, who is also a team lead as well. Carol Mothersill, co-regional manager with ECO, and Peter Lynch, who's also our team lead.
Hello.
Well, hello. So we're all scientists, but where did it all start? Does anybody have a memory or a story of how when you were young, you knew that science was it for you? Peter, how about you? You can start us off here.
I've always been drawn to science. I think, you know, my parents were ones to take us camping, so we were always out in nature and things like that. But I have a really clear memory of getting the Sears catalog and finding a chemistry kit in it and circling that chemistry kit. And that was the most important thing I wanted. So I guess, you know, when I was 10 years old, I knew science was probably going to be a career just based on that toy choice.
Right. And I'm sure if anybody young watching this are saying, what's a Sears catalog?
Paper internet.
Exactly. That's a good way of describing it. How about you, Diane? What got you interested in science?
Very similar to Peter. So we grew up camping every weekend. My dad had a busy construction business, so it was his opportunity to get away for family time. And for me, it meant freedom in the woods. So for many, many years, I didn't realize that I was developing this love of science. I just found all my questions of everything I saw, I could answer myself by spending time in nature. So over time, it just really developed a deep passion for biology with me.
So similar to Peter, I also spent a lot of time outdoors growing up, camping and canoeing. And my father was a doctor, which we had lots of really interesting dinner conversations about surgeries and births. And I found myself absolutely fascinated by some of the stories that he told. And then exploring in my backyard, we had a pond behind my house. And I remember getting a toy microscope. And I remember going and taking samples from the pond and looking at them under my microscope and seeing all these creatures swimming around. And just that really took me into biology as well.
You know, I've interviewed so many people this year, and that's a common thread. It's that pond in the backyard seems to be something that's so important to everyone, going out there and actually the doing, right? Picking up critters and then having, like you said, a dad at home who's supportive and inspiring and all the rest. Cool.
Absolutely.
How about you, Tina?
Yeah, similar connections to just to the environment. I think that probably led to my own interest in environmental science. And and I think that I discovered sort of as I got older that my mind worked in a very analytical, systematic way. So then science sort of, I kind of fell into it from that point of view, I guess, just it worked right. for where my skills were.
You're right. Growing up, I loved math, and we know that math is one of the languages in science, and so I had an opportunity in intermediate school to attend an enrichment program. There weren't many girls on it, And I just loved it. You know, looking at how things worked. My dad is an engineer. And so at home, you know, we were right in there with him fixing things, learning how to do it ourselves, from making sure we could change our own tire to fixing a small engine. So I loved science right from a young age.
So can you change your own tires? Is that what you're telling me?
Yes, I can.
Good.
I have the skill.
Excellent. That's something I can't do. So Heather, you mentioned role model was your dad. How about the rest of you? Any role models, teachers, moms, dads, neighbors, anyone who stands out? Because I think that's always important when we have someone supportive at home.
We had a high school teacher that was really into science. I think he was wanted to be a doctor, and maybe it wasn't in the cards for him, but he was a science teacher. And so he was the one that would bring in all these big experiments. So it was always very exciting to go into his class. So, you know, if there was another tipping point, it would probably be, you know, in later high school, where science became more tangible because of the things he would bring into the classroom. To do experiments. So, right. You know, there's always that teacher that kind of right. sparks a little bit more.
Heather, you were a teacher before scientists in school, correct? You did a little bit of teaching. What yeah, drew you I to taught... scientists in school though?
I taught for a couple of years. I taught grade 7 and 8 science. And then I actually was a stay-at-home mom for 10 years. Mm-hmm. And I was a parent volunteer in my son's grade 1 scientist in school workshop. And I remember walking in and participating in the workshop and just thinking, I want to do this.
Right.
This is awesome. And it was the other part of it for me was very flexible. My kids were very young and I was able to work and be able to be there for them before and after school. And I got to do, I always say, the really fun parts of teaching. I would go in, I would be like the exciting guest, and I would do yeah. all this really cool stuff. And then I would go home and I wouldn't have to mark or do report cards or any of that part too. So that was partly what drew me, and just the connection with the kids.
That's right. I think, Heather, a lot of us have the same story, right? Because I have the exact same story as you, right? Teaching, then staying at home with the kids, then volunteering for a workshop. And then my eyes were as big as the kids. I was like, oh man, I need to do this, right?
That's right.
How about you, Tina? What did you do before scientists in school?
Yeah, so I've done a sort of range of things. I've had opportunities to work for the government, doing data analysis for them. So I would look at big atmospheric data sets and try and make sense of them. So that was a fun job. And then I sort of fell into a really neat job right in my community, actually, where I was working with a local neighborhood group who was bringing pop-up shops into sort of a less than well-used section of our city. And so it was sort of a way to animate it and bring it alive. And so that used an entire different skill set from my sort of data analysis world. But I found a lot of really great connections with it too, because it turned out you use data everywhere, right?
How did you make the leap to scientists in school from that?
So again, not too dissimilar from everyone else, right? Kids at home got to be a parent volunteer in our workshop, and it was sort of just, again, the flexibility. So all of those pieces sort of came together. And for a while I was running both this pop-up shop project and doing presentations in the classroom. And it was this really great
right.
sort of merging of all my skills. And
like Heather and Tina, I had 2 kids in kindergarten and I was a volunteer, and I was like, I can do this. I want to do this. It was my foray back into the workplace. I love the flexibility, and that was more than 8 years ago now.
Wow.
Before that, I worked in the faculty of engineering in fund development. So working with professors and alumni to try and find matches and funding for their projects.
Well, how about you, Peter? What got you into this? What did you do before, actually? You've done
quite a bit. Yeah, well, I was at Bell Canada for 25 years and really enjoyed it. And after I left university, it just was a natural fit for me to go and work with computers and all that technology. So I really enjoyed that. And when I left, I had a bit of time. And so I went back to school and got my teaching degree and thought, oh, I wanted to be a teacher. In the meantime, like, there wasn't a lot of jobs available. So I thought, I'll just get a quick job at Scientists in School because I'd heard about them. And, you know, 12 years later, I'm still here. It's just a wonderful place to be. The environment is so friendly, and working with the children is wonderful as well. But once I started here, I just didn't really feel that I wanted to leave. So I stayed.
Well, I, many years ago, became a teacher, and I spent 12 years teaching science. With a science background, I was very passionate about hands-on science in my classroom. And I did a lot of work later in my career in curriculum development and implementation. Again, like many others, I had a family, stayed home with my kids, and they became my focus for 10 years. And I started to get that itch to head back to the classroom. And for me, having an impact has always been very important for me in my career. And so I came across Scientists in School in a very unusual way. It didn't exist in Calgary. And here I was actively searching every day for something in science outreach that met my vision of what science outreach should be.
Right.
And lo and behold, Scientists in School launched here, did a pilot project. And so I went to help with one of the first pilot workshops, and fell in love with what it was offering. To me, it answered so many questions that kids were asking, and it supported teachers in so many ways that teachers had been asking for years. So I was the first presenter in Scientists in School.
In Calgary, wow.
And it's just been an incredible privilege to watch this program here grow over 5 years. We'll be 6 years in January. And it's been a real gift to be a part from day minus one to you know, the start of a 6 year adventure in January.
Well, let's talk a little bit about this year, because it's definitely different. We've got COVID, and March was the first time in 31 years that Scientists in School had to close its doors. But if you fast forward to November, we've got community workshops, classroom workshops. We have already 1500 workshops booked. How did we go from closing our doors to here is what I want to talk about next. How do you take, I think we had about over 80, is it 84 workshops, classroom workshops in our catalog. How did you decide which workshops to choose first, and how did you make them into virtual workshops?
I can talk a little bit about that if you sure. like, Betty. So the first thing we did was get to know each other a little bit, because we had previously been working in WCU office, Ottawa office, the Toronto office, and a lot of us had never met each other before. So we started by doing Zoom calls, just like we're doing right now, and meeting each other. And then we broke off into teams, and that was really helpful to work with a team of about two or three people. And we decided that we would pick it was left up to us which topics we wanted to choose. I think a lot of us chose the topics that we were most comfortable with. So topics that we had actually taught before for many years. I was on the light team for the first, one of the first topics. And that was my very first workshop that I had taught was light. So we all knew the topic really well. The other thing I think we took into consideration was the materials we were going to need. So, and we ended up doing a lot of physics topics, because they were materials that we could actually put together in a kit and ship to kids that we would be able to do some really fun activities with. Some of the biology ones are a little bit more tricky to do that. And so that, I think the getting our feet wet with doing that first one that we were really familiar with, a physics ones, that then we really could branch off from there.
So one of the challenges, of course, is that we can't go into the classroom. It has to be virtual, but now the kids have to get their own kits.
I think if you imagine the excitement of getting a bag of goodies and having the opportunity to open that bag and see what's inside it, is just, you know, that alone is probably just adds to the excitement of already knowing that, you know, we're coming into the class. So so the kits is definitely a lot of what we decided on in terms of how the activities would work and what would work well in the classroom. And it really came down to what we could put into these kits. And so it was looking for the right materials that would work for the activities that we wanted to do, and just making sure that it was going to do what we wanted it to do in the classroom. So
right.
I think that those kits are so, I think that the fact that the kids get their own kits with their own materials to work with for the duration of the workshop is really exciting for the kids, and offers another layer to what we were doing even before, I'd say.
when we leave, that the kids still have materials in their hand, and we can give them extensions to do. So, okay, after we go, I want you to just to maybe change this thing to that thing, or so I'm sure that they can work on the workshop long after we're gone.
Right.
And teachers really appreciate that as well.
I think it also would speak to different learning needs. Like, I'm the type that, you know, I like all my stuff in order. And so I get my kit and I could line it up exactly how I want on my desk. And people who have different learning styles can do whatever they want.
I just recently read a teacher evaluation who said that her students went home and taught the same stuff that they learned to their families. And she'd heard from multiple parents in that class that their kids had come home and done the same activities with them because they were able to bring home the materials and show and share everything they learned in the classroom that day. So that's, to me, that is the most exciting part of these kits, is the ability for the kids to continue to explore after the workshop is over. And really, you know, we pique their curiosity and they can continue to explore. And
I was just going to add a similar story to Tina. We heard a story after a trial with a student who had done the workshop that took their kit out. It was when it was warmer, took their kit outside in the neighborhood on the lawn, got all the neighborhood kids together and took all their kit stuff out and taught the entire workshop to their neighborhood friends.
Oh, how exciting.
And I mean, that is exactly what we want to happen, right? We want that learning to continue. We want them to be excited and passionate about sharing it with other people.
Right. What are some of the challenges been doing it virtually?
There's so many.
There's challenges, but then there's amazingly some things that are just so similar. I think, you know, so the challenges are probably really the technology, right? I think that there's a lot of apprehension for the teachers. They're not sure sort of what our workshop will look like in the classroom and in this sort of virtual world. And they're always a little bit nervous about whether the connection will work and whether they'll, you know, they'll be able to see us, we'll be able to see them, you know, all those different pieces that have to be into place. But we're discovering that we can be very adaptable to all the various scenarios that can present themselves in the class. And so that's, you know, we can make it work. And I think that, and then it's always, like I said at the beginning, it's so surprising to see how things are so similar in the classroom too, despite this big difference. You know, you can still see the excitement and hear the excitement in the classroom as the students are doing the activities. And that's, you know, that's such a nice connection to have, so.
Actually, Betty, if I could add something.
Yes.
I think in a world full of restrictions due to a pandemic, there's also been opportunities. And for us, it's using technology to reach students in rural Ontario that we haven't had a chance to work with. And the pandemic, through its restrictions, has brought some equity to those schools that haven't had us before.
I was going to also add that I remember when we first talked about virtual classroom workshops, being a little bit skeptical as to whether I was going to be able to have the connection with the students, because I'm used to being in the classroom and walking around and being, you know, close to the students and being able to see exactly what they're doing at their desk. And having done a few classroom workshops now, it's amazing, as Tina said, that even, and there's been times when I haven't even been able to hear the students because of audio issues and I can just see them. But seeing the kid in the very front of the classroom with their materials, building away, doing what, and with the, you know, the smiles that you see, and the teachers have been amazing as well, communicating back and forth to us as to what the students are sharing with us, answering questions or asking questions. And the teacher has really been a good facilitator to give us that feedback. And I feel that connection is not lost, even though we're not in the classroom. I do feel that I can still get that feedback from the kids as to how much they're really enjoying themselves.
That's awesome. That's so great to hear. I mean, we've all had to adapt, right? I think our motto should be adapt, overcome, survive. And, you know, 6 months ago, the thought of doing a Zoom interview, I don't know if I would have been as excited, but we've all gotten used to it, right? All our staff meetings are like this. Every social interaction has been like this for a long time. Our book club, Heather, for a long time is over Zoom. We've all adapted, and it's great to hear that you can still connect with the kids, even if it's through a computer screen, which is pretty awesome. Now, when you develop these workshops, how do you align it with the curriculum? What's that process like?
Well, specifically with the light workshop that I helped work on. So Heather and I worked on that together, actually. And we looked at the existing activities that we were doing in the classroom and we were able to adapt them. So that was a really nice fit because it already was well curriculum aligned. And so because we sort of were able to adapt the activities for the virtual world, it still remained curriculum aligned. So we still can cover the properties of light, and we can still also connect it to technology. Each student gets a piece of fiber optic cable that they get to explore. And so we can make a really great connection to how light and technological advances are work together and discuss some of those things. So it's an ongoing process to continue to keep our workshops aligned with the curriculum.
At this point, I think we have one workshop per grade with more being added, right? Correct? I think some of the grades have two or three workshops actually in development. Where do we go from here? What are some of the new and exciting things that we have going on at Scientists in School?
We have two new pilot programs that we're running that are trying to reach more children and youth outside of the classroom. One is a virtual four-week STEM club, or science, technology, engineering, and math, where the same group of kids will come together for a four-week period and investigate different topics that we developed over the summer. The exciting part of it is that we can have kids from Toronto and Ottawa and Waterloo all in the same STEM club because we're working virtually.
Right.
And the second program that we have is called Party Like a Scientist. In our COVID world, we aren't able to always get together to celebrate milestones, whether it be a birthday, Halloween, the upcoming holidays. So we've taken our candy chemistry workshop and we're offering it to people to book, to bring friends, family, neighborhoods together for an hour and have a really fun and hands-on experience while we explore a bag of Skittles.
Yeah.
So we're excited to bring those to scientists of all ages outside of the classroom.
I've done that workshop. I love candy chemistry and the Skittles. That's a good one. I like that it's called Party Like a Scientist. That's a good lead in for my next question. How do you scientists party? What do you do for fun? Peter, what do you do?
I'm a volunteer at the Toronto Zoo. And so what I do is just shut myself off on one morning a week and go there and do interpretive. Before COVID, we were doing tours, curriculum-based tours with school groups and wayfinding and touch tables and all that kind of stuff. But it's still sciencey, but it just gets me away from the day-to-day and email and all that.
Perfect. How about you, Diane? What do you do out in Alberta besides shovel snow?
Yeah, there's been a lot of that this year already. And we're always happy to share. Just keep that in mind. Living where I do, we're so close to the mountains. So that's a big passion for me. Like, we ski downhill, cross country, backpack, hike. Any day in the mountains is a good day for me. So that's what makes my world very complete.
Well, you shared a lot of those photos when you were doing the race for charity, the Scotiabank, and the mountains were in every photo. It was stunning. It was beautiful. How about you, Carol? What do you do for fun?
Well, I want Diane to send that snow east. We two are skiers and we head to the hills every weekend. So bring on winter.
Ah, okay. Tina, how about you?
I guess I've been filling a lot of my time with baking, to be honest. Mm. So it involves a lot of butter and sugar in our house these days. Consuming it.
And Heather, how about you? What do you like to do besides walk with me
every day? I have a side job as an interpretive guide with the Grand River Conservation Authority. So I spend a lot of time outside. So I love to be outside as well. I love bird watching, canoeing, cross-country skiing, hiking. Anything that gets me outdoors makes me really happy.
That's awesome. Thanks so much, everyone. I wish you all the best. It's a lot of exciting stuff happening at Scientists in School. I think the whole process, the brainstorming, the developing of topics, putting it all together and then going live, it's been an exciting process to witness. I've seen the kids and how excited they get. I know that teachers are enjoying it, and I think we all love what we do. So thanks so much for taking the time to chat with us, and we'll see you next time. I wish I could say see you in the staff room or see you, but it'll be over Zoom again. But anyway, thanks so much, everyone. Have a great day.
Thanks so much, Betty.
Thank you, Betty.
Bye.
Thanks, Betty.
Thanks so much for watching Spotlight. If you'd like to find out more about our educational charity, our community, our classroom workshops, or Party Like a Scientist, even STEM Club, all the information can be found on our website, scientistsinschool.ca. You can also follow us on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and we're new to Instagram. Our handle is @sci_in_school. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you again on Spotlight.